Buenos días.
Again.
Dobre Oturo. Good morning, everyone. I am Maria Charlene Mangoba of St. Thomas Aquinas class.
I am Mary Faith Sanson of St. John Paul II class.
Mi nombre es Julio Nacenerio de St. Anselm Canterbury class.
St. Francis of Assisi once said, Lord, make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love.
Let this be a reminder for all of us that we Montessorians are capable of sharing and promoting peace to our nation, to our environment, and to one another.
The United Nations is an international organization founded in 1945. After the Second World War, by 51 countries committed to maintaining international peace and security, developing friendly relations among nations, and promoting social progress, better living standards, and human rights.
Every year, we are celebrating the United Nations. This year's theme focuses on the road to the lasting peace. To start our program, may I call on Charlotte Marie A. Pascual to lead us in our opening prayer.
In the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, Amen. Prayer, O God, our Father, we pray for all your children on earth, of every nation and of
remarks. SHMI Montessorians, parents, teachers, and SHMI priests, good morning. I welcome you to our UN Culminating activity. This year's UN theme focuses on bringing back together peace and prosperity. With this, I would like to share with you a very short story about people coming together to bring peace and prosperity to their land. Are you ready to listen? In the beginning, the world was still and quiet. The world seemed to be covered with rocks and stones. But if you took a closer look, they were tiny people who weren't moving at all. One day, the wind blew, warming the people and filling them with life and love. As the wind blew, they began to move. They began speaking to each other, playing together, and they began to care for each other. They explored their world and found colored ribbons scattered all over the ground. They were very excited. They ran about each other and tying the ribbons and laughing at the bright colors. Some liked the blue ones best. Some chose red. Some took yellow. And others green. Suddenly, another wind blew, making them shiver. It didn't feel like the warm wind. So they began to feel frightened. Looking to each other, they saw that they looked different with their ribbons. So they stopped trusting each other. The people with the red ribbons gathered together and ran to a corner. Those with blue ribbons ran to another corner. The green ran to another, and the yellow to another. They were huddled into four separate corners, far away from each other, and forgot that they have been friends. The other color just seemed different and strange for them. And because they were afraid, they began to build walls to protect themselves and keep others out. Before long, the red ones found that they had plenty of water in their corner. They had nothing to eat, so they became hungry. The blue have food, but they don't have water, so they became thirsty. The green have twigs for fire, but no shelter for wind and rain. The yellow had shelter, but no fire to keep them warm. They began to feel worried and miserable. Suddenly, a stranger appeared and stood in the middle of them. He looked around in amazement at these people hiding behind their walls. He called out on everybody saying, "Come out! What are you afraid of? Let's talk to each other." At first, the people just peeked out at him. Then, very slowly, they came out of their corners and stood in a circle. The stranger said, "Why don't you tell each other what you can give and what you need to be given?" It took great effort to overcome their fear, but slowly they began to speak. The blue said, "We have plenty of food, but we badly need water." The red said, "We have plenty of water, but we have nothing to eat. We need food." The green said, "We have plenty of wood for fire, but we need shelter to protect us from wind and rain." The yellow said, "We got shelter for fuel, but no fuel for fire. We need warmth." "Why don't you put together what you have and share it?" asked the stranger. "Then you can have food to eat and water to drink, and shelter and fire." As they began to talk, the warm feeling of love returned. They remembered that they once have been friends, and underneath the colored ribbons, they are just the same. So they knocked down the walls that divided them and welcomed each other back as friends. When they realized that the ribbons cost them separation, they would like to throw all the ribbons. But they know they will miss the brightness of the ribbons. So they decided to put them together and make a beautiful rainbow ribbon. That's how they got their name. The rainbow people and the rainbow ribbon became the symbol of peace. The end. I hope that this story will inspire you to become one of the colors that shares and works for peace and prosperity. Again, good morning and enjoy our special UN presentation.
Thank you very much, Ms. Christie. It is indeed true that unity is our strength. We human beings are interdependent with each other. We need to help one another in promoting peace to our nation.
In doing so, each class has started to work together in promoting peace in their classrooms. We did different activities in relation to the celebration of the United Nations. Today, we are proud to present to you each class activity. To start with, let us all welcome St. Paul class to present the continent of North America.
Hello everyone. And today we are going to show you guys our UN works, and here it is.
Hi, I'm Mia.
Angel Gabriel, M. Mercado,
Tizi,
Gabriel, Miss Jim,
Madeleine,
David Horris, Tom Jacob, Lama,
I'm going to Papa
Dom,
El Salvador,
the Bahamas,
Jamaica,
Costa Rica,
the
United States of America,
Panama,
Guatemala,
Mexico,
Trinidad and Tobago,
Dominican Republic,
North America.
Now, let's jump to our group work. Now, let's go to our individual work. Now, let's proceed to our Earth project. So anyways guys, that's our UN presentation.
I hope you learned something from this video.
That's all for now.
Thank you for watching.
Wow, that's amazing. Thank you very much, St. Paul class.
Now, let us proceed to the St. Anselm of Canterbury class to present the continent of South America.
Buenos dias! Let's explore South America. Up of 12 independent countries: Argentina, Bolivia, Brazil, Chile, Colombia, Ecuador, Guyana, Paraguay, Peru, Suriname, Uruguay, and Venezuela.
There are many festivals throughout the continent, but one of the most vibrant and colorful is a carnival, celebrated a week before Lent. It is most famous in Brazil, Rio, Salvador, or Recife.
In South America, Brazil is the largest coffee producer in the world as of 2020. We have learned that the production of coffee from planting a coffee bean, harvesting the cherries, processing the cherries, drying the beans, milling the beans, exporting the beans, tasting the coffee, and roasting the coffee.
This year has not been easy for people in the coffee industry, including 25 million smallholder farmers who are responsible for growing 80% of the world's coffee. Many people depend on coffee for their livelihood, from transporting and roasting the beans to selling the final product.
Despite the incredibly challenging working environment imposed by the COVID-19 restrictions, customers have still been able to get their hands on their favorite drink, thanks largely to the resilience of the coffee producers and supply chains.
Hi, my name is Felipe Buada. Facts about Peru. The capital of Peru is called Lima. Peru is the third largest country in South America. There are three official languages of Peru: Spanish, Cueca, and Amaya. Now, Peru is struggling to cope with coronavirus, with the second highest number of cases in Latin America. Now, the hospital and health system are in stable of collapse. Children have not been permitted to go outside for more than half an hour since March 2021. And that's all I can share with you. I hope you learned something about Peru.
Peace.
Now let us call on St. John Paul II class to present the continent of Europe.
Good day, everybody. I'm Lance Balili of Year 6. We will be presenting the activities we did for the whole month of October to celebrate the United Nations.
Hi, I am Jacob Reese, also from Year 6. That's right, Lance. Let us already begin. Our class, the St. John Paul II, was assigned to study Europe. We set the following objectives: to be familiar with the continent of Europe, to study and recreate some traditional food, and to study Europe's climate change solutions.
Europe is the second smallest continent in the world, and it is located in Northeast Hemisphere. Here is the map of Europe.
There are six regions of Europe, which are Central Europe, Northern Europe, Eastern Europe, Southern Europe, Southeast Europe, and Western Europe.
Europe is the home of the following animals: white-tailed eagle, European wildcat, long-eared bat, owls, polar bears, and the black and brown bears, elk, reindeers, badgers, tuna, sardines, and tigerfish, wolves, foxes, jackals, and lynxes.
The common languages spoken are Dutch, English, Swedish, Danish, French, Italian, Greek, Spanish, Albanian, Bulgarian, Bosnian, Serbian, Portuguese, French, Dutch, German, English, and Gaelic. But the main language they use to communicate is English.
Each of us made a country fact file representing the different regions of Europe. In doing so, we learned information besides the ones previously mentioned, the environmental issues they face and how they are addressing it.
Let's take a look at some of the work of our class. In Central Europe, we have Zoe doing Germany, Paul doing in Austria. On Southern Europe, we have Japan doing France. On Northern Europe, we have Zaya doing Norway, Alex doing Lithuania, Vico doing Sweden, and me myself doing Latvia, and Lance doing Denmark, Maki Cruz doing Iceland, Diana doing Finland. In Western Europe, we can find Nina doing Belgium, and Mary doing the Netherlands. In Southeast Europe, we find Candice doing Romania, and Annika doing Serbia. The environmental issues they face, we too, in our very own country, the Philippines. That is why the upper elementary students also figured out to contribute to the solution. Later, you will hear a report by Mary and Nina about the Earth projects of us doing. We believe that any small act we do to help bring back the health of our planet counts. So, we encourage you to do the same.
Oops, Jake. Before they witness our Earth project, first they will hear how we learned about the traditional food in Europe. Let's get hungry. Zoe and Anna, are you ready to report?
We hope you enjoyed learning about our report. Thanks.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Zoe Mielhim Abrina.
My name is Anna Beatrice Jungkook-Rida, and today we will be discussing traditional foods in Europe. The aim of this UNF activity is to be introduced to and to recreate some of the traditional food in Norway, Scotland, Italy, and Turkey. They are just some countries in Europe.
Year 5 is representing Norway, and as you can see here, Mary chose Valfer, also known as waffles. Did you know that waffles have been around since the 14th century and that there are two waffle holidays?
While year 4 talked about food in Italy, let us watch Zoe's pasta video. Yum.
You get everybody staring for days. All they see is just a young, pretty face. But I'm trying to get to know you much better. Don't matter how much time it will take. But there's something you're trying to hide.
Watch Paul Owasson's pasta. Oh, and Zoe, did you know that Paul is cooking pasta? The ingredients he used in making the pasta are basil, garlic, olive oil, and of course the pasta. He crushed the basil leaf to get its flavor to be mixed up with other ingredients. Truly, it's Paul's favorite pasta dish when he was little.
Really?
Now let us watch Mackie's video, and it's also pasta. His mom helped him make a yummy carbonara, the Italian version.
First, I start by helping my mom set up the pot and water for the pasta. I even turned on the stove for her. Added salt and oil to the water. Once the water starts to boil, I added in the pasta. Here are some of the ingredients that we will be needing. Garlic, finely chopped pecans, mushroom, black olives, parmesan cheese, eggs. Make sure they are fresh. You will also need some olive oil and 2 cups of pasta water. In a pan, my mom then proceeded to saute the garlic, bacon, black olives, and mushroom together, making sure to caramelize everything before adding in about a cup of hot pasta water to the mix. She called that deglazing the pot. She then added the cooked pasta afterwards. Here she is preparing the sauce for our carbonara by whisking the egg along with the parmesan cheese. Once everything is well incorporated, she then added 1 cup of piping hot pasta water to the egg and cheese mix, making sure to whisk it hard as to prevent scrambling the egg from the splash of hot pasta water. Added the prepared sauce to the pasta that's been sauteed over the pan and mixed everything together. She did it over low to heat, make sure that the eggs were slightly cooked since me and my sister will be eating this yummy dish too. As I heard, the Italians will just mix everything to the hot pasta but not on open fire. Season the cooked carbonara with salt and pepper to taste, and we are done. Mom plated a pasta for me and garnished it with fresh basil from our garden. We hope you enjoyed the process of how we made our carbonara at home, and hope you get to try it out by making it at your home too. Thanks for watching and buon appetito!
And J6A is representing Scotland. As you can see, Vincent made Colin sink and he used milk, mashed potato, and butter chopped onion, and lastly black pepper and salt to make the delicious dish. Rabbit, on the other hand, try making an oatmeal porridge, which looks easy and yummy. Traditional turkey dishes were also presented to other groups of year six. They are the korba, doner, kebab, and gazelle.
Oh, I hope we can try recreating those dishes when we see each other face to face. In this activity, I appreciated the oatmeal porridge because it actually kind of saves money to make one. You don't need to buy any more.
What I learned today is that waffles came from Norway. Various places found in different regions in Europe have different dishes, different flavors. Traditional food is greatly influenced by the kind of ingredients available in a particular environment, which is affected by the country's prevailing climate. This report really makes me hungry, too. Maybe it's time to say goodbye for now, Zoe.
Yeah, it's time. So, thank you for watching. We hope you learned something from us. Again, this is Zoe Abrina.
And I am Anna Kuda. Bye! Bye.
Hello, everybody. I am Mary Fiat Sonson.
And I am Nina Cruz-Aguilera. We'll be introducing
our Earth Project.
Our objectives are the following: to be able to create an Earth Project, to appreciate all the gifts of creation God has given us, and lastly, to understand and put into action our cosmic role.
Yep, that's right. Now, let's take a look at our project proposals.
We have 5 projects in total, so let us introduce them to you.
The first project is food growing. This aims to help reduce the carbon footprint, to help the planet Earth by making the air clean, to grow food, to contribute healthy food to the family, and to learn the life cycle of a plant. Actually, some have already started planting some food like okra and sugar peas. Now, let us take a look at Zoe Brina's Earth Project.
I quit sometimes. All my friends are saying that I waste my time, that I waste my time. I don't wanna tell you, I know if you care. Repeating my mind, rolling around, stuck in your bed. Burning temptation, I just cannot hide it.
Presentation, Zoe.
Now that we have taken a look at Zoe's Earth Project, let us continue. Second project is composting. Our aim is to create a compost project to help the environment by reducing our carbon footprint through this project and to witness how organic materials decompose. Thank you, Joel, for setting up your compost bin. It is on its way to decomposition. Let us take a look at Joel Labrador's Earth Project. Thank you for the presentation, Joel.
Third group is seed saving. This aims to save seeds for future use, to experience sustainable food production, to help in growing air cleaners, to save money, and to develop deeper love for God's creations. Atlanta has begun the first set of seeds for the future.
Fourth is the medical herbs. This aims to experience how to grow herbs, to grow healthy food, to learn different kinds of herbs, to save money, to learn about the needs of a plant, and to be familiar with the uses of different herbs. Matthew was very excited to begin planting some herbs already. Keep planting!
And last but not least is water conservation. This aims to save water at home, to learn how to reuse water, to save money, to appreciate the importance of water, and to learn the source of water in the household. It's Martha, Zaya, Vika, and Paul who are going to monitor how much their family is consuming and to figure out how much they will be able to save in 3 months.
Hey, Mary, what are you learning from these kinds of activities?
I learned how to compost properly and the ways to help our Mother Earth. What about you, Nina? What do these activities help you become?
These activities help me become helpful and responsible. How do you feel about contributing to global actions and solving climate change?
I feel great about it. At least, even in small ways, we can help the Earth be healthy again. What about you, Nina?
I feel great because I got to help take care of nature, which is God's gift to all of us.
Me too.
Thank you all for listening to us.
Yes, thank you all.
For that beautiful presentation, St. John Paul II class.
Now, let us call on St. Nicholas class.
My classmates and I are going to share with you facts about Africa. Are you ready?
Yeah.
SHMIMS is produced in Greenfield areas. However, it is also grown in the drought and farming conditions in Africa. Africa is the cradle of coffee and is a producer of some best coffees in the world. Of all the countries in Africa, Ethiopia and Uganda are the highest producing coffee in the continent. Wheat is a cereal plant that is the most important kind of grow in temperate countries. The grain of wheat is ground to make flour for bread, pasta, pastry, etc. Only Ethiopia, Kenya, and South Africa grow significant amounts of wheat, and they are still net importers of the grain. Among the important wheats in Africa are bananas, dates, figs, olives, and citrus. The principal vegetables include tomatoes and onions.
More than half of the African continent is covered by grassland or savanna. Northern Africa is dominated by the vast Sahara Desert and the semi-arid Sahel Zone, which also includes fertile land in the Nile Delta. Central Africa has rainforests, coastal plains, and the continent's highest mountains and lakes. Southern Africa lies mainly on the high plateau and only has a small coastal land. And one more interesting fact! The Cape Floral region in South Africa has the most plant varieties in the world.
Did you know millions of people in sub-Saharan Africa depend on corn as a source of food and livelihood? Corn is a perennial crop for many farmers because all parts of the crop can be used for food and non-food products alike. The kernels are used as a food that the husk of the corn is traditionally used in making tamales. The stalks are used for animal food and the corn silks are used for medicinal a staple food. Corn also a good source of energy and rich dietary fiber and calories.
arms up high, reach for the sky. Let's sing and move along to the silly, silly Ram-Sam song. Oh, Ram-Sam-Sam, oh, Ram-Sam-Sam, gooly, 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 Ram-Sam-Sam. Oh, Ram-Sam-Sam, oh, Ram-Sam-Sam, gooly, 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 Ram-Sam-Sam. Wanna be a Ram-Sam master? You've got to go a little faster. Oh Ram-Sam-Sam, oh Ram-Sam-Sam, gooly 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 Ram-Sam-Sam. Oh Ram-Sam-Sam, oh Ram-Sam-Sam, gooly 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 Ram-Sam-Sam. Oh Ravi, oh Ravi, gooly 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 Ram-Sam-Sam. Oh Ravi, oh Ravi, gooly 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 Ram-Sam-Sam.
Thank you, St. Nicholas, for the wonderful presentation.
Now, let us call on St. Thomas Aquinas' class to present the continent of Asia.
Namaste, Shubhrabhat.
Hello, Salamat Pagi.
Kunai din.
Alun Tuan.
Ciao, Boyzang.
Yo, Dazalma.
Anyong Hasio.
Salam, Hayir Litong.
Kuzo Zangpo Drobadili.
The name Asia is ancient. Its origin has been variously explained. The Greeks. Asia is the largest continent in the planet. The largest countries in the world can be found here, such as Russia, China, and India. 14 of the tallest mountains in the world can be found also in Asia.
Only humans that are thriving. And the continent is home to a wide range of animals and plants. For example, on the Asian continent, you can see wild elephants, tigers, snow leopards, orangutans, and many more, including some of the most venomous snakes in the world.
Food in Asia is somewhat extraordinary, such as adobo, chicken biryani, sushi, dumpling, and Chinese fried rice.
Rice is a staple food on the continent, and most of the produced rice is eaten here as well in many Asian countries. Like here in the Philippines, we have rice for breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
Can we live without rice? Most of us agree that rice is a staple of more than a half of the global population. In Asia, we use rice in sushi, in curry, or even baked into pudding, and most especially in our favorite sinangag.
What distinguishes Asia from the rest of the world? Its great dependency on rice. More than 90% of rice is produced and consumed in Asia.
Countries in Asia, such as China, India, Indonesia, Vietnam, and Philippines, produce highest amount of rice.
Apart from the various constraints, the anticipated changes in global climate in the form of rising temperature, increasing amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, greater frequencies of extreme weather events such as droughts and floods, and greater incidence of pests and diseases are likely to make things more complicated for rice production.
But still, rice continues to remain a political commodity in Asia. Countries in the region are still extremely concerned about rice food security and treat it very differently from other food commodities.
The future growth of rice supplies, however, seems to be on shaky ground with several emerging uncertainties, including a possible rice area decline, a further slowdown in productivity growth, and climate change.
Most experts predict that area under rice in Asia is likely to fall because population pressure, water shortage, and competition from other crops. In addition, the ongoing structural transformation of Asian agriculture with aging farmers and outpigmentation of rural Europe may also influence rice farming.
Ultimately, the onus falls on policy makers to adequately fund agricultural research and on scientists to develop technologies that are climate proof and that enable farmers to grow more with less inputs and a smaller environmental footprint.
So, if you're a big fan of rice, then don't worry, because the future of your favorite complex carb is in good hands.
For flight 89B, Oceania, Australia. We are now inviting those passengers to begin boarding at this time. Please have your boarding pass and identification ready. Regular boarding will begin momentarily. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome on board flight 89B bound to Australia. Please take your seat and fasten your seatbelt. If you have any questions about our flight today, please don't hesitate to ask one of our flight attendants. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have just arrived at our destination. Welcome to Australia. You will learn a lot from this trip. Tour guides will assist you on your journey. Thank you for flying with us. Thank you for choosing St. Francis of Assisi Airlines. Have a nice day.
This is the continent of Oceania, often called Australia and Oceania, the smallest continent in the world. Australia is surrounded by the Indian Ocean to the west, Southern Ocean, to the South and Pacific Ocean, to the east. It is found in the southern and eastern hemispheres. The main languages spoken in Australia is English, but you can also hear many native and aboriginal languages.
Let's now look at the countries that make up Oceania or Australia. The only country within the mainland continent of Australia is Australia. The 14 countries considered to be part of the geographic region of Oceania are Australia, a country, a continent, and the largest island in Oceania. This is also where the city of Sydney is located. Sydney is the largest city in size and in population in Oceania, and where the famous Sydney Opera House is located. Australia is also well known for its Great Barrier Reef, a colorful sea full of tropical fish that you can see even close to the beach.
Continuing with the countries in Oceania, we have Fiji, a popular tourist destination because of its beautiful beaches and coral reef, Kiribati, Marshall Islands, Micronesia, Nauru, the smallest country in this region. It is so small, in fact, you can drive around the entire country in 1 hour. New Zealand, known for its glaciers and geysers. Palau, Papua, New Guinea, Samoa, Solomon Islands, Tongva, Tuvalu, and Vanuatu.
As you can see, Oceania is mostly ocean. The climate in Australia varies greatly. This means you can experience very high heat air in areas like in the inner part of Australia. Popular tourist attraction is a remote area called the Australian Outback, where you can expect temperatures as high as 120 degrees Fahrenheit or 50 degrees Celsius.
To experience very cold temperatures in areas like New Zealand, in fact, some parts of New Zealand and Australia see snow. Many people ski at Australia's highest mountain, Mount Kosciuszko.
This is the flag of Australia. The name Australia came from Latin Australis, meaning southward, and dates back to 2nd century. Legends of an unknown sacred land, that is Terra Australis Incognita.
Talks about Australia. Did you know?
I just believe Australia to be the world's oldest continent.
Of Australia is made up of flat desert areas.
Australia, the only continent without an active volcano.
Australia's sheep population is 14 times more than its human population because of this. Australia stands for number one in the production export of wool in the world.
Australia is the home in many unique animals like kangaroo, emu, and porcupine.
A large population of different indigenous groups of people in general, Australians and are people of Tamil heritage to groups that lived in Australia before British colonization. They include Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples of Australia.
Time story has on the history of Aboriginal people, their relationship with the land, and their spiritual connection. For Aboriginal people, their connection to the green time is still alive and vital. Today, and will remain so.
holistic sense of oneness and interdependence, reverse for land and country, and a responsibility for others.
From a very young age, Aboriginal children are told about their relationships and links to others, and are taught to show respect to their elders. In Aboriginal communities, elders play a vital leadership.
Out of sheep meat, meat pie was made, and the Australian meat pie is one of the favorites of the many. An Australian classic enjoyed by young and old. Enjoyed as an individual pie or family size. Some people call this the national dish of Australia.
If you've ever had the privilege of traveling to Australia, you would most likely have had the pleasure of eating a delicious meat pie. It's a small hand pie, stuffed with ground beef or chunks of steak, onions, sometimes mushroom or cheese. Made with a puff pastry crust and a short crust pastry base.
This sweater is so comfy and soft. Did you know, out of sheep wool, this sweater was made? The wool is a type of fabric derived from the hairs of various animals. For example, sheep. And since Australia has a large population of sheep, they're the main producers of wool around the world.
You enjoy our trip? Wait! There's more! We'll be entertained with a dance. It is one of the dances in the island of Polynesia, under the country of New Zealand.
St. Francis of Assisi class for that wonderful presentation.
Congratulations everyone for this successful event. We know everyone gave their best in making this presentation possible.
Thank you, Mary. Now, for our closing remarks, may I call on Zoe Buster from St. Paul class.
Good morning, good afternoon. I hope you enjoyed this presentation that was given to you. I encourage you all to help our environment, like example is planting a new plant you've never tried to grow before. I expect that there will be ups and downs since it doesn't really grow right away. It can help give you a lesson that you're not able to care properly at first. However, with the proper research and care, it will bloom unexpectedly. It might not be a big of a help, but at least it's something that, something small that we can give to the earth. The love and time shared upon a living being that has no mouth, ears, or eyes, or even a nose, but it has life that will do its duty for the world. It's one of our missions to fix this broken world we live in. The cruel world may be harsh, but keep the faith strong. That is something that they cannot take away, of course. Well, that is all for my remarks. Bye.
Thank you, Zoe Buster, for that heartwarming message. Now, let us call on si Auntie Mati Lingaya to lead us in our closing prayer.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen. All-powerful God, You are present in the whole universe, and in the smallest of Your creation, You embrace with Your tenderness all that exists. Pour not upon us the power of Your love, that we may protect life and beauty. Fill us with peace, that we may live as brothers and sisters, harming no one. O God of the poor, help us to rescue the abandoned and forgotten of this earth, so precious in Your eyes. Our Father on earth in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, Sian, for that wonderful prayer. Once again, we are your hosts. I am Mary.
I am Julian.
And I am Shirley.
Let us always remember to promote our lasting peace to the world.
Have a good day, and God bless us all.